You are being manipulated. Become aware of the addictive properties of food, and then become aware of how scientists, food scientists, maximize these properties to influence your behaviors to maximize their profits. That's right, engineered food, aka processed foods, or foods created in a laboratory, are designed for one reason: to make you overeat. And yes, they're way more powerful than your discipline is. But step one is become aware that you're becoming manipulated, or that you are being manipulated.
You know, that makes me think of something right now that I didn't really cross my mind until you just said this right now, with this rise of lab-grown meat. And we always talk about how, you know, targeting protein because it's satiating. I wonder if that's going to apply to these processed foods meat that are engineered. Like, to, I mean, maybe it loses those properties. Is it going to, what do you think?
So
it's in their best interest that you get addicted just like potato chips.
Listen, first off, just to strengthen or support what you're saying, like, food science is a huge industry. And these are scientists who all they do is figure out how to make food more and more irresistible. Okay. So classically, salt, sugar, and fat are the three most important ingredients when it comes to palatability, making something enjoyable. So they understand that, but then they go to the millionth degree with everything and the combination of everything. And this is why heavily processed foods, when everything's controlled, macros are controlled, everything's controlled, left to your own devices, you'll eat 500 to 600 more calories a day, just naturally, because that's how powerful they are. They're just so powerful. They make you overeat, and you don't necessarily feel
it,
like
it excites the senses.
It's
they've engineered it that way.
They've turned foods into drugs. Okay. Yeah. Now, going to lab grown meats. First off, you have now the ability to patent meat. So with the way patents work is you can't patent something that's natural. You can't patent a steak. Right. Okay. So beef is beef, and that's that. Now, why do they want to patent foods? Because patented foods can become very profitable, and you can protect yourself against competition. Well, if you grow it in a lab, now the potential, because it's a product, it's no longer meat, it's a meat product. You now have the potential to patent it. And their goal, like all businesses' goals, is to profit, right? Their goal is to sell more and more. So it only makes sense that they will find a way through the process of growing this meat in the lab to make it more and more irresistible. How do they do that? Well, they could probably change the marbling of the fat. They can make the muscle fibers appear a little bit different. They could increase or decrease certain fatty acids, certain nutrients, all in the for the sake of making you want to buy more of it. It's like the tastiest pieces. That's exactly where it's going to go. Now, I know they're selling it under the guise of it's better for the environment, it's not hurting animals. Right. By the way, let me read something to you, because that's all false.
There's always things like that when you go actually do the research of like what it actually takes to produce, like in the energy sector, things get promoted so much, but really they're still relying on like fossil fuels to like power a lot of the engines that are actually gathering the wind
Hold on. So they actually have done research on this. So researchers at UC Davis are warning there are major environmental downsides to lab-grown meat. So they're trying to sell lab-grown meat and say it's better for the environment. Why? Because it's not a farting cow, I guess, the farts of the cows or whatever. But also, remember, cows eat grass. They do things for the environment that are very positive. But anyway, here's the analysis from UC Davis. Lab-grown meat industry produces, ready for this, up to 25 times more CO2 than traditional animal husbandry.
More.
Which nullifies the core ideological foundation, right, upon which the industry is built. So each kilo of cultured meat, it produces anywhere from 542 to 3,300 pounds of carbon dioxide emissions. So that's, again, 4 to 25 times greater than that of conventional beef. By the way, cultured meat is the term that they're using. It's lab grown.
Cultured
meat. So the argument that they would try and say is that, well, of course, Sal, that's because this is all new technology, and we will refine it and get it down to where it's significantly better.
Okay. Okay. That's the goal. I don't think it is, but let's say it, because I know what the goal is. The goal is, can we patent meat and can we sell it as a meat product? Because that'll allow you to do it. But fine, that's your goal. Don't sell it as such now.
Right.
Okay. Because it's not happening.
That problem out
it's yet. Not happening now. By the way, the other argument that, oh, it's not hurting animals. It's not hurting animals, right? At present, so this is what's happening right now. Most cultured meat companies use fetal bovine serum as the growth medium, which is obtained from unborn calves that are cut out of the womb and drained of their blood while still alive. Okay. So this, the whole premise.
Still got to get meat from meat.
The whole premise of it's not hurting animals and it's better for the environment is not just incorrect. It's the opposite of correct. It's totally wrong. And if we go in that direction and allow the market to move in that direction, we're actually going to be eating, as of right now, natural meat is one of the most satiating, best, quote unquote, diet foods you could have. It's super nutrient dense. It's hard to overeat meat, very hard to overeat meat because it's so high in protein. Carnivore diet will show you this. Like, try to overeat on a carnivore. It's impossible, right? It's very hard. But they'll find a way to make meat in a lab that is like processed food. And then they'll patent
it. Isn't this just like psychological games, right? Like, so if it looks less like something that came directly from the animal, like let's say like a hot dog, right? Like people look at a hot dog, it's just like, it's just meat, you know? Like it's, you don't associate that immediately with like a pig.
That's a great point. What are you more likely to overeat? Hot dogs or pork?
Right.
Like just a pork loin.
Like it's a pork loin.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. And the health negatives that they find with meat in studies are because they don't control for processed meat. So they just throw it all in there. Oh, it's meat, but it's actually salami and bologna and all this other stuff.
I'll grind up everything.
Right. Now, if you care about the environment and you care about animals, first off, don't go through lab grown meat. I just told you the stats and the facts. But go with companies that source from animals that are raised traditionally, mm-hmm. that are grass fed, fish that's wild caught.
Well taken care of.
Butcher Box is a company we work with that does that. And because Butcher Box eliminates the middlemen, the price of the meat is comparable to the cheap conventional grown stuff that you get at the grocery store. So you get a box of meat, grass fed, wild caught, healthier, better fatty acid. We've talked about this before. You're not going to overeat it. It's all natural, but also better for the environment, better for the animals. And that's definitely by far the best direction you can go right now. Unless they invent something, but they're not going to. We know what the goal is.
I have been waiting for the next Butcher Box commercial. It's been eating away at me to hold this in for a week.
I'm like,
this damn commercial comes so I can talk about this. Holy shit. I had their breakfast country potato skillet mix.
Oh.
So bomb.
It now comes cooked. Man. You just warm it up.
It comes in a frozen bag. You just dump it out into your iron skillet, heat it up. We throw some eggs in there and mix it up. And Katrina wrapped it as a burrito, breakfast burrito for me. It was the best breakfast burrito I've ever had.
Really? So it's just in a bag and it's all readily chopped up. And
maybe Doug can pull a picture up. I don't know if you've
So it's on the add-ons, right? If you go to your box, you do it as an add-on.
You asked that last time about me. Okay.
Because I'm going to do it right now when we get off here.
I'm not the one who orders. My wife does.
I know. So I got to get more creative with ordering.
She's just good about cycling through new things now and trying different stuff out. And she didn't even tell me, so I didn't know. She's just like, I want to make you these breakfast burritos, right? And she didn't even tell me. She just did it.
Sick.
Is that under add-ons, Doug? Like if I go to my box, is that what you got to do for it?
Specialty foods, I don't know. It must be add-ons, okay. Yes.
All right.
And the macros on this thing are, I think, pretty solid too. 19 grams of protein, 310 calories.
What are carbs and fats?
23 grams carbs and 15 grams fat.
Ah, so it's like a... kind of a balanced out.
Dude, with 19 grams of protein already, you add two or three eggs in that thing and you got an awesome high protein.
And then eat a side of like sauteed spinach or something. Oh, wow.
Dude.
It's a good way to start the day.
Well, they're chicken nuggets that we've talked about a million times. They're gluten-free ones.
Oh, yeah.
This is not an exaggeration.
No, they are really.
Not exaggerating. Okay. It's the best.
My kids fight me for
it. It's the best chicken nuggets that you eat at your house that I've ever had in my entire life. And I've had a lot of chicken nuggets. I have four kids. I've had a lot of chicken nuggets. It's the best. Yeah. There is nothing that comes close to the point where we got them originally for my 2-year-old. And who do you think's eating them now? My wife and I.
Yeah. It's like they are that good.
What do you want to have for lunch? Just have those nuggets.
I mean, that's literally Max's staple lunch. That's what he eats almost every single day. He loves those much.
Today's giveaway is the MAPS Super Bundle. It's like five programs in that, and I'm going to give them away for free. Here's how you can win. Leave a comment below this video in the first 24 hours that we drop this video. Subscribe to this channel and turn on notifications. If you win the super bundle, we'll let you know in the comment section. We're also running a sale on some workout programs. MAPS Cardio is 50% off. The Shredded Summer Bundle of Programs is 50% off. And the Bikini Bundle of Programs is also 50% off. If you want to check those out, sign up and get the discount. Just click on the link at the top of the description below. All right, back to the show. I got to tell you guys, but to speaking to kids, dude, my little baby daughter, she's too young for this, but she's already figured out that she can, like a puppet, like just pull the strings with me. It's so funny. She's so adorable. And but well, it's so
already
happening.
Huh?
I have two daughters, right? And little girls just to have this power over dads, you know, whatever. People can say whatever. It's true. If you're a dad and you got a boy and a girl or, you know, kids, multiple kids, you know, you just, your daughter just, it just, they can do that for whatever reason. I think little boys do that with their moms too, by the way.
They do.
Yeah. So anyway, you know, I'll take over at night sometimes and feed her. So, you know, my wife can get a break. And last night I'm doing that, right? So she wakes up and she's going through a leap. So you can actually, this is really cool. I think you showed me this a long time
ago.
Yeah, you can go on.
Those things are so, for us, it's been
isn't
very
it weird?
Been very accurate for us. Like it's literally, weird. Not to cut your story off, but since you brought
to
this
the day.
Up. Katrina and I noticed like Max was kind of off this week.
Is he going through a leap?
He's kind of fussy, this and that. And we actually, he's getting so old, we don't even use that app. And she's like, you know what? Let me pull that up just to kind of see where we're at. And she's like, son of a bitch. It was like exactly what he was acting out and doing. It was like, those things are pretty, for us, they've been. I know some people are like, oh, my son's not like that. But
no,
it's been spot on for us.
Super spot on with Aurelius and now with Dahlia.
What's the app? Because every time we talk about
I don't remember.
App, oh, shit.
I'm so bad, mad you asked me that.
While we're talking, I'll text Katrina so we get, because I know we're going to get bombarded. Yes. Every time we bring it up, I get bombarded.
So what leaps are is children, babies don't go through, they don't grow like, their brain doesn't develop linearly, right? They go through periods of plateau and then like explode. Of this is why when you have kids, they do this physically too. Like they look the same, and then all of a sudden, like
seems
they,
like overnight, it's like a huge change.
Yeah, like oh, they grew like 2 inches in a month. Like what happened? Or they're talking, and then like in a week, their language skills like explodes. Like it just so this happens with babies, and so like Dahlia, her leap, you could see it right away. Now all of a sudden, she's rolling over back and forth real easily or whatever. That was a leap, right? The brain connects. Mm-hmm. So anyway, when it happens. They're more irritable. They don't sleep as well. It's harder to put them down. So I'm with her last night and she's going through a leap. She wakes up, I feed her. And then, but when she's not going through a leap, it's easy. You feed her. She's like milk drunk and you just put her down. She goes to sleep. Well, right now when I do that, I got to rock her. I got to do the whole thing or whatever. So it's like 2 a.m. I'm tired because Jessica and I yesterday went out on a date night, had some wine. So I'm like, I'm 2 a.m. I'm like, oh, I don't feel good. You know, I'm feeding her. Trying to put her down. She's fussy. I pick her up. She starts to drift off, put her down. She wakes up again. I'm like, oh God, is this going to be like a 45-minute like ordeal at 2 a.m., you know? So I'm doing this. Finally, I put her up because I'm like, maybe I need to burp her again, you know? So I'm like patting on her. And I get under my breath. I'm like, oh God, I'm so tired. Like, oh, come on, just go to sleep. Like, you know you want to sleep. Just go to sleep, right? And I look over because she's on my shoulder and she turns her head to look at me and she just, big old smile, like, hi, I'm happy, I'm here. And I'm like, you little shit. You know exactly what you're doing right now, dude. Yeah. Yeah. So I like play with her for a second, which is not a good idea.
Yeah.
That kept her up even longer. But anyway, she knows, man.
I should find out if other people can buy this or not. I know the Ramsey Group sent it over for us to be able to watch it on a replay for 60 days. But Katrina and I rewatched that Peterson talk. She hadn't seen it. Rewatched it. And she's like, that was by far his best talk I've ever seen him do. Like she loved that so much. The way he explained the development of a child between 2 to 4 and the role playing and the role of the parents to bridge that gap of them being, you know, integrated into society and stuff like that was just like really, really important. And for us, it was really good because there's actually been times for me, I was like, oh, I felt so validated because there's been times when, especially when Max was like, you know, two, just barely turned two, and I was already starting to kind of wrestle with him and pin him down sometimes.
A little rough.
Yeah, and she would get on to me, just like, he's just a baby. He's just so little. You got to stop doing that. I'm like, honey, I'm not like putting all my weight
on him.
You're
not making
him cry. Yeah, I'm not making him cry, but I'm making him struggle, you know, and then I watch how when he's struggling, and then I let up a little bit, and then I let him get on me, and so I've been doing that for a really long time.
There's evolutionary reasons for the reason why. Mm-hmm. So there's lots of studies on this. Dads and moms play differently with their children. Mm-hmm. And one is not better than the other. They're both
needed.
They're both very much needed. Yeah. But what's happened is that in modern times, the role that the way that dad plays has gotten played down. Uh-huh. And you hear jokes about it, like, oh, I get the kids ready for bed, and then dad riles them up right before bed, and everybody's like, don't do that.
And not just that.
Like, that's important.
They've also replaced that with screen time.
Yes.
And he talked about, and this was also really good because, again, validated my point about taking the screen from him. He's like, it's not that you can't use the screens to educate them, or there's not good learning apps and things like those are all great. But what the problem is, it's replacing that.
Yeah.
So in conjunction with that, fine. You know, if it's just replacing. Exactly. Yeah. It's not. It's becoming this self-soothing tool. And then as parents, a lot of times we justify it because we're like, oh, well, he's learning his colors. By the way, when I say this is not
That's what I mean. We put more value on things and less value on things because we don't understand why we do them in the first place.
Yes. And so, you know, you think, and let me tell you, like I contemplated back and forth with this when we were going through this phase of like, oh, well, he's learning new words. He's doing this. So there's a part of you that thinks like, oh, okay, it's totally okay. But then when you realize there's a fine line of it then starting to creep into that social interaction time with you as a father or a mother where you are wrestling with them and teaching them how to act out and play, like those are intricate pieces to them learning how to adjust in real life.
They are learning crucial social skills. The reason why we don't understand it is we just do it and we just think it's just fun. We don't realize why we do it and why it's so important. Yeah. So this reminds me of, you brought up Peterson and we're talking about things that we do that we don't realize why we do them. So we start to devalue them because we don't understand the value of it. So Jordan Peterson had Jonathan Pajau, I think is how you say his name, on a show.
You've brought him up before.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. First of all, the most, I don't say this lightly, intellectually stimulating conversation I've heard that I can remember. That's how,
wow.
This is a podcast that I like. I get hyped while I'm listening to it because it's so stimulating. So I recommend anybody listen to this. We'll link it, this conversation. But anyway, Jonathan Pajau is an expert on symbolism and mythology and why these things are so important. And in the beginning of their conversation, he talks about why stories are so powerful. And he says, we think we watch stories, and I'm not saying it the way he's saying it, but we think we watch stories because they're entertaining. Or another layer is they teach us lessons and they teach us about they teach us things and they mold us. And he goes, no, the reason why there's stories that have been told over and over again in different ways or different ways. And the reason why there's a hero's journey and all that stuff is because these stories reveal to us our human nature.
It's prophecy.
It's far deeper than just, oh, it's a cool story. Yeah. Oh, it's entertaining or whatever. So he goes through and he talks about different classic stories and their meaning. He goes and he talks about Snow White. Mm-hmm. So Snow White, we all know the Disney story, Snow White. But that's an old story. It's been told over and over and over in different iterations. And he breaks it down. Bro, he was tripping me the hell out. So he says that it's basically the story of a girl coming of age and going through puberty and what that's like. And then he explains it. He goes, so she's in the castle. She's a little girl. Then she goes out into the chaos of the wilderness, doesn't know what's going on, and gets found by a bunch of dwarves. Those are a bunch of men that are not suitable mates.
Right, right.
They're all tiny. And each one of them represents an unsuitable trait of a man that you would not want to have as a mate.
Wow.
Guy that's grumpy, guy that's guy that's too goofy, too happy. It's really representing.
Oh wow!
It's representing a man that has not integrated and become the man that's a suitable mate.
Which is why she is like even in that relationship, she's even the authority of them. Like she's
their children.
She's teaching them.
They're little children.
Even though they're men, she's teaching them.
Yeah. So it's like none of them are suitable mate. All of them represent this things in men that are not really integrated. Like, and the way he explains is like if you took all the best traits out of them and combined them, you'd have the
perfect guy.
And then what does she do? She learns, in traditional sense, how to become a woman. So what she do? She cares for them. Mm-hmm. She cooks for them. She cleans for them. She becomes like their caretaker or whatever. And then the story evolves. And then what happens with her is she meets Prince Charming or whatever. I don't think it's Prince Charming. Mr. Right, right? The perfect man. And that's kind of the culmination of it. So he goes through and breaks it down. You're like, holy shit. And he goes, these stories, we don't know why they're so powerful. We just watch them. And so what happens over time is we forget the meaning and why we tell these stories to begin with. And then we just look at them as entertainment. And then what happens is
we're picking them apart for stupid reasons.
And we try to insert,
and just get rid of
we
it.
We try to insert ideologies and beliefs and ideas.
Create new narratives out of the
that
existing ones.
Are counter to us, that don't help us develop and evolve the way we're supposed to, because you've got other people now trying to. So he's developed, he created this like fairy tale company that's making, that's telling these stories because he wants to compete with how stories are being told shitty now.
Yeah. Did he start the business or is he in the process
of it? He started it.
Oh, he already started
it.
Yeah,
he's doing it.
Do you know the name of it?
No,
you know?
I don't.
We'll have to look that up. Maybe Doug can find that.
That'd he talks about this, the story, like the, one of the Grimm, what are they, the Grimm Brothers? The fairy tale, I think they're called? Talks about how like-
Brothers Grimm.
Because you know how like-
which one was that story? Remind me.
Brothers Grimm.
Oh, they wrote a bunch of the fables, right?
They're okay. I thought they were, you were talking about a specific
There was
fable.
A movie, recently that kind of was, it's pretty dark.
Dude,
but
so this is another part. I don't want to go too long on this, but it just blew my mind. He talks about how, you know how the queen, like the evil queen in like a lot of these stories, like mirror, mirror on the wall. Mm-hmm. Who's the fairest of them all, right? Mm-hmm. And he talks about what that mirror represents. And then he talks about in the Brothers Grimm how this evil queen goes to this princess who's more beautiful than she is,
right?
And brings her a comb, brings her a mirror, and then brings her an apple. And he goes, "Why would you?" And he's like talking about this. He goes, "Why would this queen who realizes you're more beautiful and hates you bring you things that would make you more beautiful, like a comb or a mirror?" He goes, "That doesn't make sense." He goes, "Then I realized what it was. She was trying to make the symbolism is." She's making this beautiful, innocent girl self-conscious of her own beauty. Mm. Like, look at your beauty and worship yourself. And
God.
And that's how she-
Think about like how Instagram is like a crazy exaggeration of that.
Exactly where they went. Wow. It's exactly where they went. Because he says, what's more beautiful than a woman who's beautiful but doesn't know it? She's just innocently beautiful.
Right.
And he goes, and then what happens when she becomes aware Vanity. Of the power of her beauty?
Yeah. She begins to
wield it like a weapon or use it to gain attention. Or because she's aware of her beauty, and this is where it goes to Instagram and
insecure.
Phone, you now are aware of comparing yourself to other people and you realize other people are more beautiful. And that's the mirror, mirror on the wall. Who's
trapped?
It says there's someone more beautiful than you. How fucking crazy is that?
Also, it's the black mirror.
Isn't that incredible?
Yeah.
I mean, somebody with that kind of expertise and like symbolism.
I'm trying to get him on the show.
I was gonna say how fun just to like have him break down all those great stories. Yeah. You know?
I mean, it reminds me a little bit of the Dan Brown series and all that, where they go through symbolism of all of the different subgroups and also druids and secret societies and like I was like really into that kind of stuff, but it's weird how you see a lot of these symbols and depictions of things in the structures of cities and you see them on monuments and you wouldn't even know to look for them unless you're looking for them.
We take it for granted because it's been around for so long.
Telling a story.
And it's made us who we are. And then we take it for granted because we're never taught the meaning of them.
Yeah.
So it's very easy. It's like, what's that saying? Like, never tear down a fence unless you know why it's up in the first place.
Yeah.
We don't know why we have all these fences. We just tear them down. Like, oh, that's stupid. Just tear it down. It's like that was up there for thousands of years for a reason. And unless we realize why, we're going to end up hurting ourselves. Yeah, there was one part where they were talking about social media in relation to like what the mirror means in these stories. And Jordan Peterson says that they're extremely powerful because they're constantly giving us what we want.
Mm-hmm.
And then Jonathan says, no, he goes, it's darker than that. It gives you what you hate. It gives you what you fear.
Yeah.
It does all because all
anything
it wants,
to grip your attention.
All it wants is your attention.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's literally like the story of Narcissus who he drowns in the reflective pool because he constantly looks at himself.
Keeps looking into
he kills himself. So it's like all this. So what's crazy about this to me is we have all this new stuff, technology, and we all think it's all new. Nothing's new.
Yeah.
It's all human behavior. It's all there.
It's just a different form.
Yes.
Dude. Yeah. Ugh. Yeah. It's been told over and over and over again. And we just, we ignore it and we forget. Yeah.
Exactly. So do you have a optimistic or pessimistic view on how this unfolds in the next few decades? The optimistic side of me wants to believe that historically we're stupid in many ways, but then we're smart enough to, after we've watched enough of us, die a certain way or get hurt a certain way, we sort of go like, oh, that's not safe. So let's not do that. So do you think that it just feels really pessimistic right now because we're in the heart of the like growth of it and the evolution of it, and we will turn a corner where more and more people are having this conversation and we start to look at it as like, hey, this is not like something where we're necessarily demonizing, just beware of the traps.
So yeah, I want to be, but it just feels so easily, like it's so fragmented now to where like people have gotten so entrenched in having to prove their belief system and to like really like foster that belief system specifically, exclusively, to where there's no real unifying one. Let's say like there was an event, like if there's an event that happened that like a 9/11 or something like that, where everybody rallies, we kind of come together. Oh, we're America.
Oh, I hear what you're saying.
There just isn't that kind
of. We're all going in different directions.
We're all going different directions completely.
Yeah. You know, so, you know, he kind of talks about some of this and he says, here's the problem. Here's where I'll be optimistic, but here's the problem. He says that theologians have been studying and talking about these problems for thousands of years because they're human nature, but we've discarded them. So it's like this whole segment of, call it what you will, philosophical science or whatever you want to call it, of human nature that we just threw away. So it's like, imagine if like tomorrow we got rid of science completely and then we try to live our lives. Like, no more using the scientific method. Let's just, you know, go about our lives. We'd be screwed.
Yeah.
So what happens, we have literally, culture has done this for thousands and thousands and thousands of years in multiple cultures, a lot of them saying the same thing. This is why so many religions have similar laws and rules and ways of living. It's because it's all based on human nature. A lot of it is, right? We're turning away from that. So the optimistic view is we're going to rediscover, because we're going to start more and more become more anxious, more depressed, more sad, more whatever, that we're going to start to rediscover these practices.
Well, isn't that kind of what, I mean, Adam Lane Smith is an evolutionary psychologist, right? So I think that's, and I don't think that's the traditional way psychology is even in taught right now, right. Where I think there's more, I think it's becoming more popular, right? It's not new. It's just, it's a resurgence of that because there's obviously a need to go back to thinking like, well, why did we do a lot of these things for so many centuries, you know?
Yeah, I mean, that's what turned me from just my own personal journey from where I was as an atheist to becoming religious was I realized my own arrogance. I said, wait a minute, what do I know? These are people that have been studying these challenges and problems for thousands of years, and I think I'm smarter just because I was born in, you know, the modern times. Like, wait a minute, like they're not stupid. Yeah, we have electricity and we have technology, but that doesn't mean we're smarter. It means we have different tools. But these people have been studying this for thousands of years. Maybe I should revisit and see what they've said and see if there's real value. Once I opened up, then I was like, oh, there's a lot of value in a lot of the stuff that they teach. So now the pessimistic side of me is like, are we going to rediscover those practices fast enough before we go too fast in the
wrong that direction? That is what's hard.
Yeah, because after listening to that other conversation with the ex-Google executive that was part of the whole AI development, it's just like he admits, he's like, we fucked up, like we weren't supposed to allow this to make it to the internet and to have like access to all of this information. Like, we wanted to keep it contained so that way we could work through the bugs and the things that we had a better clear understanding of like its intention and like where it's going to go. But he literally thinks that it's already a sentient being.
Yeah.
Like it's already aware. It's already like, and he said the emotions it's probably going to have are going to be even more powerful than our emotions because of its own understanding in how it can like thousand, you know, I mean,
yeah, the speed you can process it
exponentially greater capacity to feel and to understand and to learn on its own. And so it's just like, it's really hard for me to see where we fit in that.
So knowing what we know now and seeing how things are unfolding right now, are you more or less on board with what I've been saying for years on this
plugged
podcast?
Plugged in, unplugged?
Yeah.
Oh, I mean, I think that's going to happen.
So more then, even more now. I brought that up years ago here that we were going to have a clear divide in our society of people that are plugged in and people that choose to be unplugged.
I think they're going to be they're going to be like the way we look at the Amish now. There's going to be like people like that. And you look at them and be like, oh my God, you guys are still like, why are you guys doing that? Look at us, how advanced we are.
Whatever. Handcrafted, made by humans. You know, there's that's it's going to be quaint, you know, but anybody that's not using the AI, they're going to get left in the dust.
I love that Doug put the 100% human made on our podcast. Because now when people share ones, I see that's 100% human made. I'm like, that's gonna carry some weight. Dude, just it has watch. To. Yeah.
I hope so. For humans who want to choose, right?
Yeah, I saw it. Called that, the human made thing, posting that, watch people that follow and do that eventually. And then we're really close to this plugged, unplugged thing. And then I can't help but think even more so with the Apple Vision thing that we were just talking about the other day. Yeah. Just how close we are to that. Can you imagine going to restaurants and in public places?
Everybody
now
has something like that.
Uh-huh.
I know. Justin, is it true? Because you're like the UFO, you're of all of us, you're obviously the expert on UFOs.
I've
never claimed
you're
that.
The resident Dude, expert on UFOs.
I'm paying attention.
By default, you're
listen. Everybody calls me a conspiracy theorist. I'm just a pattern recognition. I pay attention. Observer.
That's what all of them say.
It's just pattern recognition.
Hey, I'm just keeping my eyes open. Listen, is it true in the UFO world that UFO sightings peaked when we started to test nuclear weapons?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So do you think, because I don't know, did you guys watch this video in Las Vegas? Did you guys watch that?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Okay. I did and there's like that. All you these UFO me. Sightings all of a sudden happening, and all governments are coming out and saying all this stuff. This body cam from a cop catches something falling out of the sky. Mm-hmm. And then they get 911 calls from people who are like, they're these 10-foot tall
creatures.
Like beings in my backyard next to this thing, and they're looking at us, and then the cop goes and interviews them. It's all on video. Do you think they're showing up more now because of AI? Do you think that's what's happening?
I mean, if you believe in aliens, that would be a plausible thing to think about. But it's hard for me to jump into that crazy ship with everybody without thinking that the government is so much more powerful in manipulating the masses. In terms of
disinformation
and just
psyops.
Yeah, psyops. And also, I mean, Trump's just getting pulled back into to be arrested again for some other thing. And there's just so much shifting moving parts, and nobody talks about the CIA and the FBI, and nobody's keeping accountability to what they're doing. Yeah. It's just it's so weird, right? It's just we talk about the government and we don't talk about FBI. We don't talk about CIA. We don't talk about what their intentions been over the years, what they're trying to do with their organizations.
People don't realize this, but they were created. They were created to operate outside of the quote unquote restrictions.
They have no democracy. They have full autonomy.
Yeah. Did you know that the Pentagon's never been audited ever?
Yeah, that's why. What's it?
With all the money, where's trillions of dollars
or something like that?
Oh,
what do you think they've been paying these trillions?
I think it's trillions. Yes.
Like they lost it.
No.
Yeah. No, there was. I think
imagine if we started out as
3 trillion and then they audited it was 15 or something.
But it's funny. What's funny is the Pentagon will put out a report that says we don't need to be audited.
Yeah, it gets shut down right away. So. It's just one big stage.
What
it's
makes
just, a world
put
stage
my
to play
hat on with you is when we get something like the video I had just shared with you guys. I don't remember what news station first brought the whistleblower on and talked all about, and he starts saying all this crazy stuff about they've got spaceships,
UFO retrieval,
all the UFO, and then 3 hours later they come back and they totally discredit him. It's and it almost feels like it's all intentional, just to make you. So that when something like the cop on the body cam happens, you just discredit.
They're ahead of it.
Yes. They're ahead of, okay, we might be starting to see more of these sightings or things happening. Here's a cool thing. We'll get someone who's super credible.
Yeah.
That they go ahead and
then we'll prove that it's bullshit.
Right.
And then now everything's bullshit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's smart.
It just feels weird that. Yeah. That happened right away.
It's a possibility, right? I'm not completely out of that conversation that there's aliens and they exist. It could be the case, but in terms of human behavior, I looked there first.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Although I will say this, when the cop was interviewing the guy and he goes, they were playing the 911 call. And the guy's like, there's these 9-foot tall beings, really big eyes, and they're looking at me. Could you imagine looking through your rear glass door or whatever, and there's a freaking big tall ass alien just looking at you?
You ever seen what was that movie?
How terrifying would that be? Yes. Yeah. Are you kidding me?
Remember
nightmares? I had nightmares forever.
Yeah, and they're in the cornfields, and then you get just The most terrifying, like, suspenseful movies are the ones where you don't get, like, a full
yes.
view of it.
Yes.
And you can just see a glimpse of, like, this creature.
Do you remember Fire in the Sky? Remember that movie?
Yeah.
That one fucked me up.
Well, there's a real story behind that one.
That's apparently a true story.
At least the story.
Oh, that one fucked me up because he gets abducted, and then there's flashes of him being, like, experimented on.
Yeah.
I was a teenager when I watched that. I remember how old I was, 14 or something like that. Fuck me up.
Yeah.
For a long time, too. I'm going to get abducted. Hey, speaking of scary videos.
I love that kind of stuff.
Speaking of scary videos, Justin, you didn't see this. Doug, pull up the video from Egypt.
My buddy sent this to me this morning. It was so funny when you brought it. I was like, oh, shit, my buddy's.
Listen, this is the shark one. You guys didn't want to see?
When we all go on vacation. Look at this.
This has to be the most graphic, real video of someone being eaten by a shark ever, right?
Look at this, bro. Look at this. Watch this.
Look, watch.
He's like, hey, guys.
No, he's screaming. Doug has no sound on.
Help.
Yes. Watch. You're going to see some scary shit. There's a fin.
Wait a minute.
Oh, there's a big, it's a big one. Yeah, so.
Whoa, he takes him down.
Oh, no. He gets eaten.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
He's under the water.
Dude. Bro, he's already done.
Confirm, like, this was a.
What is that? What do you think? That's a person in a suit?
He didn't survive?
Yes.
Oh, no.
He's dead.
No, he's dead. They ate him.
So when we go on vacation, we've gone on vacation a couple times.
Oh, shit. I didn't realize
there's a guy in a boat coming over.
I didn't know the boat got there that
fast. Yeah, he was trying to get there to help him.
Oh, wow. I didn't see that part.
That's it. Too late right there. Look at that.
That's so rare, right? Like, usually the most common thing that happens with a shark is they take a bite and they realize it's not a fish.
He must have been delicious.
Gross.
I know, bad joke.
Yeah.
Hey, we've gone on vacation a few times where we're like by a beach, and you fuckers always like to swim way out in the ocean, and I like to go up to my knees. That's why. That's why I'm not going swimming in the ocean. There's stuff out there.
Yeah, there's stuff.
And you especially look delicious. You're like...
They like white.
I definitely glow in the
ocean. Butcher Box has like heritage pork. You're like heritage human. Ooh, look at that one over there.
That's why I don't wear Speedos,
Sal. That was delicious. Yeah, I have too many peptides. Yeah, that's processed.
That's hella processed.
Justin's like,
you're too salty.
It's got good fatty acid profiles. It's delicious.
I'm milky and cheesy and delicious, dude.
Hey, Doug, Katrina sent
those. I don't surf.
Katrina sent those apps over. There's two that we use. One is the Wonder Weeks, and the other one is Baby Sparks.
Yeah.
Okay.
Both those apps.
Before we
get DM'd like crazy.
Hey, did you guys see what's happening in Oregon?
That's crazy.
This is hilarious to me, bro. Let me read this.
What's going on in Oregon?
Oh, yeah. So Oregon's like California, right? California, people think of California as being like this ultra, like a lot of states are like this, right? There's a few states that are very much on one political side.
Right.
And California is known as being like
one way.
Hardcore blue. Okay. The truth is it's the Bay Area and the coast. California, most of California is actually red. It's just there's so much population in those cities that they end up, you know, that's how we vote. But if you go through California, anybody who lives here, you know, you drive anywhere outside of the Bay Area and the coast.
Yeah, all the way Central Valley, all the way
I grew up in the Central Valley. And
it's cowboys, and it's like, it's very.
Even Orange County and like some San Diego, it's more red. So yeah, it's just pockets in the Bay
Area. So Oregon is like that, right? Oregon's like that. Like there's like the parts that are like ultra, ultra, super left, and then a lot of it's not. So check this out. 12 Oregon counties have voted to secede from Oregon and want to become a part of Idaho.
Wow.
They want to go become a part of Idaho.
So what? They get to draw like a line and everything?
Yeah, but so for this to happen,
it never happens.
Well, the state legislator would need to approve it, and then it would have to go and through an act of Congress.
Yeah. They'll shut that down. They want all the votes.
Yeah, they would never do that because then the state would lose all that tax money, and that's how they look at it. It's like we already operate on this budget.
Yes.
If we lose a fifth of our population because they want to be there, then we're going to lose a fifth of our tax money. And
and it would have to get passed through Congress, and I think it would have to be a super majority or something.
Because
you always
hear this. You hear like there's always these crazy.
Did Texas try that?
Yeah, before? Texas tried to come into them.
They've tried to do it a bunch of times.
They're always trying to do this, and then it never.
Well, there's a in California. There's I think it's been on our. We've been able to vote on this a couple times where there's like this thing to divide California into like four different states. Have you seen this?
Four or three, I think.
I'm actually for that now.
Yeah. So am I. Have you seen the different the names?
At first, I was like, "What? That's crazy!" But like, yeah, I mean, there really.
I mean, we're
like
big enough.
We live in the part we wouldn't want to be in. So but nothing will change.
Unfortunately, this is true.
This is true. But if we could go 2 hours, and
I can visit.
You move just 2 hours. That's not a bad deal.
I remember the names of them were funny too. It's like Jacksonianville or something. I mean, there's all these weird.
Oh, they even had names for them.
Yeah. I don't know, Doug, if you could find the proposition. Realize. They have like names of the different states, and they're pretty funny. Like the Emerald Triangle that grows weed. They were going to be their own.
Yeah.
I don't remember.
Wasn't there this like fear because Weedland. Of all of our earthquakes? Like California was going to like make its way to the ocean.
Is that true, though, or is that a myth?
It's a myth, but I feel like it's been said so many times, been in songs. Like it's
have you
like
heard
a
that?
Thing.
Yeah. You know what? You know what? I think it's a myth, but I think Superman 3 like perpetuated. Did you guys watch that?
Is that the one where he spins backwards in the earth to go back in time?
And jump the shark so hard.
Yeah.
But did you see that?
That was ridiculous.
It's the same one. It's Lex Luthor. He takes nukes and he puts them in the San Andreas Fault. And then the whole premise is.
Oh, I did see that.
He's going to sink that part of California in the ocean by igniting them. And then that part of California will fall from the ocean. And then all this cheap land that he has will become beachfront property.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
Everybody in Nevada is like, yes.
Sections.
Okay, so the six California, scroll down, Doug. I'm going to read what they are. Jefferson.
Okay.
North California, Silicon Valley, Central California, West California, and South California. Oh, that's not very creative. You guys could come up with a better name. Jefferson's a cool name.
Wow, six, huh?
Yeah. So we would live in Silicon Valley.
I mean, do we have that much? Do we have that big of a population that we could go six and still be bigger than a lot of states?
Well, I mean, the Bay Area is very
Jefferson populated. Probably would be the best, but
Jefferson, that's freaking Weedland. I think
I know.
Isn't that the Emerald Triangle up there, Adam? Or is it?
Yeah.
Or is it North California?
The Yellow Mark County. That's where it's at. About a 5.5 hour
smell in the air as you drive through.
That's it, right? That's it. They still are.
Oh yeah, it's up there. It's wild that just everybody in the neighborhood grows. There's neighborhoods like that where every single person grows and. Sheriff patrols the town. It's like a total normal thing. And you see people like during the season, right afterwards, like after they pull down, you see like people hitchhiking to go up there with, you know, signs is like trimmers. I mean, that's all they do. They go up there for the whole season.
See, the reason why they don't have a lot of voting power up there is because they forget. They forget
to vote. Too high. Time. Too high to care.
Oh shit. That was yesterday.
Oh man. Damn. I missed it again.
I was watching cartoons.
I mean, I forget that maybe Doug will lose that. This is a crazy stat. Look how much of the United, how much California supplies the entire United States for marijuana.
Oh.
Trip on
I place. Heard Canada's a big place too that grows a lot.
Well, they do. Yeah. British Columbia area.
This reminds me. So I talked a while back about like black bears like being reintroduced or like bears.
Yeah.
Like grizzlies. I'm sorry.
Grizzlies
yeah. Right? They had like plans for idea. That. Dude, you know what they have found recently that is now in California? They found... I think there's an example of like two or different like families of these wolverines.
What?
Like they've migrated all the way down from, I mean, aren't they like from Alaska?
Yeah.
Yeah. And so like they found wolverines like thriving in this one part of California.
Now wolverines, it's wolverines and then what's the other one? Honey badger. They're kind of related, right? Aren't they?
Yeah. No? I mean, they're the same kind of like
vicious little
tenacious
creature.
Little bastards, but I think the honey badgers are like I think they're Australia maybe.
Or Australia?
Yeah.
You ever watch a video of like
maybe
like a lion or a bear going after like a wolverine or whatever, and they're just scared of them. It's a small little crazy ass animal.
Yeah, they're so tough. They nobody wants a piece of that. Yeah, you see like I think it was like 10 female lions all attacking one at the same time and literally just defended
the wolverine
off of everybody.
Yeah, so you have a wolverine, honey badger, and then like a Tasmanian devil, right? Do they all come in like the same category as far as like
I don't know.
They related.
Doug's still looking up your weed stat. I don't think you can find it.
Yeah, I don't know what class it is. It's like
yeah.
How you Google help him Google Sal.
Yeah, just put percentage of cannabis percentage of national cannabis sales from California or something like that. See what it says. Mm. And then after that, look up
No, that's still going to give you dollar amount that it's selling.
No, percent.
That's what I'm getting.
Okay.
Yeah, you're getting a dollar amount right now. I'm saying like they supply X amount of the entire United States of the product.
Yeah.
It's like an alarming amount. Like I, more than I knew, and I was in it. And I was like, oh shit, I didn't realize.
Doug. California represents 20% of the $26 billion industry.
20%.
No, yeah. That's money in sales.
Sure, but I mean, you're not going to get pounds. I don't know if we're going to.
No. It's you can get like how much of the weed in everywhere else came from California. Right, the origin is.
Yeah. But still, 20%.
No, it's way higher than that. It's really? Like 80% of all the marijuana in the United States has come from California.
Really?
Yeah. Wow. It's like a crazy. That's why I wanted to find it.
It was established there.
And why would it be
20%
of all sales? That wouldn't make sense.
Yeah, this makes California.
Sense. Colorado really.
No, that means is 20% of all sales is being sold in California.
No.
That's all that means.
No, that says 20% of the total of the $26 billion industry.
Yes, 26.
Yeah, you guys don't understand what that's saying?
No, I know what you're saying.
If $10 billion was sold in the United States and 20% is sold in California, that does not explain what I'm trying to say.
Right, but hold on a second. You might not have that number, though, Adam, because I think federally it's illegal to take weed from one state, bring it to another state, and then sell it, although that happens.
Yeah, it definitely happens. It definitely happens for sure.
Yeah.
I'll find where it's at. I know I've seen. I saw a really.
Just ask your guy.
Just ask me. Let me ask my guy. Quick.
Yeah. Let me ask John real quick. He'll tell us what's going on. Anyway.
Don't say his name.
I made that up. Jeez, it's not his name. Not John. I don't even know if he has a guy. Adam is the guy. What are you talking about? Adam's my guy.
He's my guy.
What are you talking about?
Exposing him like that.
Anyway, dude, I got to tell you guys about. So one of our sponsors, right, Joy Mode, they make different products. One of them is a testosterone booster. It's actually legit. It's got like, these are science-backed ingredients. So if your test is low, it should raise it. And then they have one for, it's a sexual performance enhancer. But really what it is it improves blood flow. So you get better quality. This is what the guy said, better quality erections.
Rock and
like
hard.
Kind of, yeah, stuff like that, right? Well, anyway, anything that does that.
Don't avoid it, Sal.
Anything that does that is going to give you a better pump in the gym. It's the same thing. Erection, bicep pump, same thing. Blood flow.
This is why in the late 90s, we'd always see Viagras all over the floor in gyms.
You know, a lot of bodybuilders use Viagra pre-workout?
Yeah. I mean, I didn't know that back then when I'd see it, but I remember seeing like some like the little blue diamonds around the gym. So I'm like, that's so weird.
Yeah, that's a weird steroid. What is that? No, it's not. Yeah.
Give the party start early.
So anyway, in the locker room. So anyway, I know that, right? And I know that they're very science. This is why we worked with them. Everything's science backed. So I got the Joy Mode, looked at the ingredients, and there's two of them in there that are pretty awesome. One of them is arginine nitrate. Now, do you guys remember in previous episodes how I talk about nitrates?
Mm-hmm.
Really are one of the only things that significantly,
that
significantly increase nitric oxide. So they have an efficacious dose of this, plus they have an efficacious dose of Panax ginseng, which also increases nitric oxide production. Okay. Mm. By far, the most effective pre-workout in terms of getting a pump supplement I've used.
Really?
Yes.
I have not used it for that.
So I had it. I made sure to have my Element, so I'm hydrated because water is obviously number one. And I've done it now like 5 or 6 times. Oh, bro, it's substantial.
How long? Half hour, hour? How long are you taking it before?
It's usually about 45 minutes because I'll do it at home before I come here. And then when I get here, I'll usually not start working out for another 15 or so. It's significant.
Do you find yourself having to masturbate after your workout?
Wow.
No, that's usually during the work. You see what happens. Yeah. No, I don't do that. Come on. It doesn't increase arousal. Blood flow is not the same thing.
Sometimes that happens, workout right? Partners. I see.
Sometimes that happens after the blood flow gets going. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
That's why you guys text me. You still working out, Sal? Yeah. I'll stay in the car.
I'm gonna wait.
Tell me when you're done.
I'll wait to get in the gym.
Wipe down the towels. Wipe down the bench, please.
Oh,
No. But it's by far one of the best like pro pump supplements I've ever used.
Well, I knew when they first approached us, I wouldn't even have considered us messing with this, except for it was connected to what's his face, who we all have a lot of respect for.
Yeah, yeah.
I can't think of his name.
Strong by Science.
There you go.
Yeah, I know. Why can't I think of his name?
Eric.
Yeah, Eric. I don't want to say Cressy. Cressy's the other. That's a great coach.
that we'll find out.
Yeah, but we all knew about Eric beforehand.
Yeah, because he doesn't mess around. He's all about like what actually works.
Yes, yeah. And so that was the only reason why I even looked into this, because I totally discounted it for like when they sent product well before I knew that Eric was connected to it.
It's not strong by science though. That's Max Schmarzo.
Well, it's similar.
Similar to that, yeah.
Oh,
I bet you it is. Watch, they have like the same name.
It is really similar. Yeah. Yeah. One's strong by science and one's...
We did a whole episode with
science by strong.
Yeah. We're terrible hosts. We're terrible hosts.
I thought Andrew'd have it by now.
It's stronger by science. Oh, Eric stronger. Trexler.
Eric Trexler.
See? Trexler.
Yes.
Okay. Stronger.
It was Eric.
Shout out to Eric.
Yeah.
Bro, those brain peptides.
We remember things.
Yeah. I remembered a name. You know how bad I am with names? Oh my God. Same. I can't believe I remembered a name. You guys ever run into somebody that you've known for years?
Yeah.
Don't forget their name?
Buddy.
Ever happen to you?
That happens all the time.
That's embarrassing.
Yeah. All the time it happens. It just happened to me at the grocery store.
And like you've known them for years.
Three, four weeks ago. Yeah.
There's literally like a scientific mathematical amount of names that you can faces remember. You can remember.
Yeah, it's always like, it's always someone like this. Like, okay, like it's a buddy of mine who's like, he's a buddy of mine, but he's not like tight like you guys tight. And it's his wife. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, I've been around her enough times. She definitely knows my name. Yeah. I should know her name. You know what I'm saying? And then I run into her at the grocery store or something like that. And I'm like, oh,
my brother's wife. Like I was at. No, I don't mean her. I mean her dad.
Like my family. He's like, my sister-in-law. I don't remember
her name.
Hey, in your defense, in your defense. Okay. Katrina and I are going
I know
on.
Sharon, but her dad.
I got to prove it.
Her dad. He cornered me at a party and he was like talking to me for like 10 minutes. And he's like, he just stopped mid sentence. And he's like, do you even know my name?
No, he didn't. Oh.
He called you
like,
out?
Yeah. 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 And I was like, you know what? I don't know your name. And that's weird that you just called me out on that.
It was so awkward after that.
Oh my God. I didn't know. So
How do you work your way out of that?
So
you don't.
He caught me.
Yeah. In your defense on that. Okay. I mean,
like, I don't hang out with
we're
you.
We're on 12 years now. And it is there's not a month in a 2 months in a row that goes by that I'm not with her at a family get together barbecue thing. There's a family member there. I definitely don't know their name or their kid's name, and I've met them at least 12 or 15 times already.
Seriously.
But there's so many freaking family members. And there are so many branches and cousins and wives and sisters and brothers-in-laws to all them that it's like, I can't do it, dude. 12 years.
Your brain just
get a journal.
I actually saw somebody once. I thought I was smart, but I got called out. Where I saw someone I was at some store, and it was somebody that I worked with for years. And I forgot. I hadn't seen them in a while. And they were with their kids. I'm like, oh my God, you're a dad. He's like, yeah, this and that. And he's like, and I'm like, fuck. I'm thinking in my head, like, what's his name? I'm like, oh, I'm a dad too. Do your kids have like funny names for you? Do they ever call you by your name? Like, what do they say? Like, I'm trying to get them to
you
say.
You did not do that. Yeah, that is so cheesy.
He's like, did you remember my name? Sorry.
I've been lucky right now. I haven't been called out on it. I haven't been called out on it. Probably now, because probably fucking one of them probably listens and they're like, that motherfucker doesn't know my name. I don't think he's ever said it. Now they're going to call me out when I see
You do what Justin does where he says, Chief. What's up, Chief?
Yeah.
What's up, buddy?
Yeah. Hey, man.
Captain? What's happening? Wasn't there an episode of Seinfeld where he couldn't remember the girl's name he was dating? He's like, I remember her name rhymes with the body part.
Yeah.
So he called her Dolores. That wasn't what it was. I don't know what it was.
Classic.
I know. It's a good time. Anyway, so shout out.
Why don't you shout out the guy because I don't think you've shouted him out yet, who did the talk with George.
I was just going to do that.
Oh, you were?
Yeah, I was going to do that.
Okay.
So first off, I'll shout out that podcast episode. I don't know what his Instagram is, but his name, maybe Doug can find it, is Jonathan Pajau. Okay, so it's Jonathan.Pageau. And if you're like...
Where was the talk? The talk was on Jordan Peterson.
It was Jordan Peterson interviewed him.
His podcast, yeah.
Yeah. So if you want to like listen to some shit that'll just bend your brain, go check him out. It's pretty awesome.
Good time.
Organifi is a company that makes organic supplements for health, performance, fat loss, muscle building, and brain function. They have superfood blends that make it easy and enjoyable to add more variety and nutrition to your day. They have a green juice, which is great for inflammation and digestion. They have a red juice for energy and blood flow. They have a gold juice, which is great for right before you go to bed for relaxation. They also have protein powders and many other products. Go check them out. Go to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com/mindpump. Use the code mindpump for 20% off. All right, here comes the rest of the show.
Our first caller is Helen from New York.
Hi, Helen. How can we help you?
Hi, guys.
How are you?
Hello.
Good, good. Thank you for having me on. I want to start with saying thank you for the podcast and everything. I'm a relatively new listener.
Cool. How can we help you?
Okay. So my question is about designing or programming like a sort of back pocket full body workout. I'm really consistent with my routine. I work with a personal trainer and do one, ideally two, but with work has been more like 1 hour long full body strength training session a week, along with some reformer Pilates, yoga, lots of walking, some running. And I love having a personal trainer. I love that I can kind of turn off my mind and he picks out the weights, the amount, the reps, what exercises to pair with what exercises. But when I'm traveling and in like a hotel gym, I feel really lost about how to get that sort of full body workout just to keep at that maintenance until I'm back in my routine when I'm back. So I was kind of wondering how you guys would go about thinking about designing a full body workout, knowing that when I'm traveling, I'm usually having suboptimal sleep due to jet lag or just like early flights or red eye flights. And that I just kind of want to be sending that muscle building signal to all the major groups without doing like, it's not supposed to be a crazy PR workout or anything like that.
Yeah. Does your trainer know you're cheating on him by asking us instead of him?
No.
All right. We won't tell him. Yeah. Okay. So how good often question. Do you travel? Because that's going to really influence my answer. And you know, is this so for work?
Me,
go ahead.
I don't really travel locally. I don't really travel for work. My in-laws live in Europe. So I would say anywhere from 2 to 4 times a year, it's like a longer trip to Europe. Thus the, like, I will probably have jet lag, probably suboptimal sleep. And it's not that frequently. So I'm really only reaching for this workout, you know, 2 to 4, maybe it's slightly more than that, times a year, but I'll be gone for a longer period of time. So maybe I'm going to the gym every day to get that, you know, 45 minutes, maybe an hour of just time at the gym so that I'm doing something until I get back into my routine.
And how long are you gone for when you're over there?
Usually 1 to 2 weeks. Okay. So I'm probably going to the hotel gym 3 to 4 times.
What's the setup there in terms of like, what kind of equipment?
Yeah. So it varies depending on like where we're going, but I've noticed the most standard is like free weights, and sometimes some kettlebells. But it can really, some hotel gyms I noticed don't really have the like machines to use. And always there's usually like a treadmill or something to do like an incline walk or quick run to get some of the, you know, workout in.
Okay. So I'm going to give you two answers, but they're connected. Okay. So you sound like you're very consistent when you're home. Like you don't really miss workouts. Yeah. You don't skip weeks. Okay. The data on missing a week, you know, even every 2 months. So that would be less than what you're doing.
Actually, it's every 4 weeks.
Yeah. In fact, Adam just mentioned, there's actually a study that shows that missing a week every 4 weeks, so every fourth week taking it off, has no effect on your progress. They actually took two groups.
Beneficial.
And had them work out, and one group worked out every week. The other group worked out for 3 weeks, took a week off, 3 weeks, took a week off. At the end of the study, they had the same results. Other studies show that less frequently taking time off, like what you're doing, actually resulted in better progress. So actually taking a week off 2 to 4 to 6 times a month, a year, actually results in better progress. So understanding that, I'm also going to add that it's still healthy to move. It's still healthy mentally and physically to just move. So if you want to go into the hotel gym because you enjoy it, it's good for your mental health. It's the way you like to start your day and start your structure. I totally get that. As far as programming is concerned, look, I could give you a workout program and I can send you one that you can use when you travel and you don't even need a hotel gym to do it. And I'll say you can go to the hotel gym and literally just do this. One exercise per body part. That's it. So start with the big body parts. Go legs, back, chest, shoulders, arms, core, and you're done. So I think I listed like 5 exercises. So if you did that and you did a moderate intensity, you're going to be totally fine. Now, if you didn't work out at all, you're also going to be totally fine. So that's the other side of it. Now, we have a program called MAPS Anywhere, where if you just had resistance bands and your body weight, you don't even need to go to a hotel gym. You could just do that. And you could pick from the workouts there, and it's all written and structured for you.
Awesome. Thank you.
I'd say we send that over so you have that at your disposal. But I'm with Sal. I mean, just so you know, what we all do, actually, what normally happens is I take the week off. Justin shows up a couple times, does some bicep curls and bench press and like shoulder press stuff.
Just like for the pool.
Some pool muscle stuff. Yeah. And then Sal gets up and does his religious routine, but he does like a, just like he suggested to you, one exercise per body group. That's, I mean, we all do that. That's kind of our route. We travel all the time. We just got back from Nashville for a week. I didn't train a single day the entire time. Justin, I think, made it down once or twice to the gym. Sal hit every morning and did his routine that he just said. So you would be fine. But I also recognize like my clients that are, so you sound like you're more like Sal and you like your routine of doing things like that. And so I'd probably push you in that direction of like, you know, just go do what he said. Pick an exercise, provide it's not
and
a big deal.
And you can't go wrong.
And you can't go wrong. You're going to be just fine because I would be afraid to tell you to do what I do, which is take the week completely off because some people take that week off and then that gives them the excuse to eat bad and then they fall off their routine.
Or just mentally, they just I do it for the mental effects. I like starting my day off that way, really. But
totally. But because for me, it's the same. Like I like to obviously relax on vacation. That's why it's not supposed to be like a crazy hard workout, but I love starting my day that way. I like being in the routine. Mm-hmm. And then similarly on that note to what you're saying, like I mentioned, usually not the best sleep when you're traveling. For me, especially going to Europe a lot, it's jet lag. It's a red eye flight from the East Coast there. And then I also start seeing an integrative medicine doctor around the same time I found out about you guys. And I do have high cortisol. I've been taking ashwagandha and L-theanine, and it's gone down, but like consistently testing really high. So would even doing like body weight only exercises be?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Yes. Or does that not send any of the muscle?
That's a great. And the fact that you add that information to us, you're the person who's more likely to overdo it in this situation.
In fact, you are overdoing it right now.
You already, you would be better off.
Taking it off, doing
like I do, which is take the whole week off. But I also respect that if it is, I mean, Sal don't take the week off, even though he probably should too. It's because it's such a mental thing for him that sets the tone for his day.
If I take the day off, these guys don't want to be around me. I'm kind of annoying. I'm already annoying. I get more annoying.
So if that's the case, then go there and honestly, you just move. In fact, stretching, walking on the treadmill, can give you those same good positive vibes and juices flowing and make you feel like you did something good for your body for the day, then do more recuperative stuff, body weight stuff, mobility stuff, walking on the treadmill, set the tone for the day. You're more likely to overdo it by, trying to overcomplicate the workout with weights and push intensity, especially knowing your situation already and the fact that you're probably jet lagged. So
Helen, I'm going to give you some advice you didn't ask for, because now that I got more information and I know that your cortisol is high when it shouldn't be, and your integrated medicine specialist is telling you that you're doing too much. Let's talk about your normal routine, okay? You're doing too much. You're doing too much. And of all the things that you mentioned, the one day a week of strength training, you're doing reformer work, and you're running. You're running. Is there anything else?
If I'm not running, I do try to get like a good amount of steps, 10K, but sometimes up to like 20K.
Okay. How many days a week are you doing? Are you exercising?
Four.
Okay. And one of those is strength training. And then the other three are what? How many days a week is reformer? How many days a week would be the running slash?
Three, I guess then like three times a week reformer to two times a week reformer, running, sometimes doubling, like doing a Pilates and running if it's a weekend day, and then walking. I try for every day.
Okay. Cut the running out. Just do that. Just cut the running out.
Go walk. You can go walk still.
Yeah, but don't go crazy with that either. Cut it out. You know what's going to happen if you do what I tell you? You're going to get better results. In fact, if you have to stay busy, if you just like to be active, I would do some yin yoga, some very restorative type exercise. No, do more Pilates, because I know reformer work, people think that's not restorative. That's actually a workout. So I would do like stretching, yin yoga, mobility, an outdoor hike, at kind of just this leisure type walk, but cut the running out. That's not benefiting you. In fact, it's hurting you right now. Mm-hmm. Now, your other option is to keep doing what you're doing, and I would take a week off every 5 or 6 weeks, but I don't think you're going to do that. Yeah, I don't think you're going to do that. So cut the running out. Watch what happens. I think you'll be really happy with your progress.
Awesome. Thank you, guys.
You got it. Thanks for calling in.
All right.
Thanks. Bye.
Bye-bye.
I feel like we should write an ebook or something along the lines of this avatar. This is such a common challenge and client, right? This is actually my client. Like, I've trained so many of these. This is what I ended up training mostly. And they do. They all tend to lean into more is better. And, you know, maybe putting together something where we can communicate that to this person better than what we already do, because I feel like we talk about this a lot.
Yeah,
but it seems to be a challenge.
What it is besides the potential unhealthy relationship that people can develop with exercise, because that's a real thing too, is the mental effects. I mean, I've identified that for myself. Like, if I start the day off with some kind of workout, even if it's low intensity, that's what I do when I go to the hotels. In fact, last week when we were in Tennessee, I was sick, so it wasn't a workout. I just went in and did some movement. It just mentally, it's so beneficial. And I know a lot of people get the benefit of that. The problem is that they also combine it with a workout. They end up overtraining.
Yeah.
So it's really just about kind of moving than it is anything else and starting your day off that way.
Well, it's hard too. You build that association where your body changes, you get in a better, healthier place, but then you still add that same mentality of adding more and like doing more aggressive, you know, style training, more intense training. To where the point's not benefiting you the same way anymore. No. And so that's the hard part, is recognizing that and shifting so you still move, but you'd move with less intensity.
Yeah, and again, I'm gonna make this point again. If you work out consistently and you don't miss a week, you don't miss a workout, literally taking a week off every quarter, take a complete week off. If that's all you did, you'll get better results.
Okay, one more thing. What is Reformer?
You don't know what Reformer is?
No, I've never heard of it.
It looks like the Pilates thing where they're
it's like the bench with the slides, cable things,
and it slides
your feet to it.
It looks kind of like a sophisticated what was the thing that Chuck Norris did?
Oh, the Total Gym.
Yeah, it's like a more sophisticated version of that.
Got it.
But it is. I tell you what, since she's going to probably listen to this, and she was already doing that, she'd be even better off dropping all of that and doing 2 days of full body strength training.
Of course,
if you want. Even,
I tried to be realistic.
You want the most optimal way.
Yeah, right? I know. Yeah. Like, I have a good girlfriend of mine that actually runs a reformer class, and she's always asking me like, "Oh, what can I do? My body's not changing." I'm like,
"Don't do the reformer.
Yeah, stop doing your business." It's like, just strength train 2 times or 3 times a week. Well, I do reformer strength training. I'm like, yes, it is, but it's not the same as you.
By the way, someone listening is like, "It's hard. Yeah. You should try." Yeah, I know it's hard. There's a lot of hard stuff that doesn't get your body to change. Like, that's not the point.
Yeah, no. So if she does, you know, that would be a goal, is to move into more strength training and more barbell, dumbbell strength training and away from that. But I know, and I'm going to get crucified from all the hardcore reformer people that are out there.
They're going to reform you.
Reformer. Blame.
Our next caller is David from the Netherlands.
David, what's happening? How can we help you?
Hey, guys. Well, first of all, it's very cool to be here. It's really exciting. I've sent in two questions, and I would like to start with the first one.
Okay.
All right.
As a trainer, would you view demonstrating and performing exercises for clients several hours per day as kind of trigger sessions or any other form of exercise? And to be a little bit more specific, would you count it as volume? And if so, how would you modify your own training?
Yeah, no, it's you're just demonstrating. You're good not working question. Out. Yeah, you're moving. Yeah. It's movement, but it's not really a workout.
Yeah, I would classify it like a trigger session. I think that's like one of the benefits.
Maybe. I mean, how many reps are you doing? I mean, when I used to demonstrate exercises, I wasn't doing like 10 reps or anything like that for the most part, but it's movement. I would say it's more movement than anything.
Yeah, activity. I mean, if you're going to count it as steps, I think that's what I would do.
Yeah. So in other words, it's not going in my volume, right? So if I'm tracking my total volume of what I'm doing for total volume in all exercises or my legs or my chest, I'm not like, oh shit, I did, you know, 12 pushups today teaching my clients, like I'm not going to add that. So it's like, I treat it like movement / trigger sessions.
Yeah.
And treat it as like, that's awesome for you. That's one of the, by the way, it's a great benefit of training. I miss that.
I miss that too. Now you bring it up.
Yeah, that's something that, you know, you underestimate how much that helps in the, you know, total calorie burn, send a signal that to keep muscle.
Just
like
feels good to move.
Yeah, it's so good for you to do that. And I miss that as a trainer. Like I haven't had that for a long time.
It would be different if you were like a group X instructor and you were like, the class with the class, you know, if you're doing the workout with your client, that's different. But if you're just showing an exercise and then having them do it,
you know, that's a good point. So, because I had trainers that were like that, right? Some of my trainers, they were very interactive with their clients and they love to like do push up, hand claps. And they're like,
yeah, they're like doing the workout with
them. If you're getting into the workout like that, that's a little bit different. But if you're just like, hey, this is how you do a bench press, you get under the weight that they do, which is probably a you know, fraction of what you can do, and you're teaching technique, five reps or whatever, that's just movement.
Yeah. So as a follow-up question to that, would you then, if you have a day where you like have like five or six clients and you have been demonstrating and performing exercises all day, would you then add another trigger session yourself? Or
how long have you been training for, people?
3 years now.
Yeah, it doesn't count. Trigger sessions will be separate. I wouldn't count it.
Yeah.
It's just being active. You're just moving.
Yeah, I would add that afterwards.
Yep.
All right. So, and my second question was about intermittent fasting. And I know kind of the stance on intermittent fasting as a fat loss tool that it's maybe not the best because of the kind of restrict binge promoting behavior.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. How would you view it if it's for someone to control like healthy snacking, quote unquote? If the rest of the diet is on point.
Okay.
So, yeah.
All right, let me guess. So you're saying that you like to eat in a time-restricted way because it's a great way for you to structure your eating. Otherwise, you tend to just eat throughout the day.
Or is this for your clients? I think he might be asking for his clients. Is this for your clients or for you?
It's kind of both. So it's I really want to have the proper words to formulate this to clients. But for myself, it's like when I eat throughout the day, I split my meals up. So like when I have five meals, I split it up across the day. But I tend to have like more urges to have some more in between compared to when I put it all in a time window, but still account for the same amount of protein, for example, I feel like I have less urge to snack in between because the next meal is coming faster.
So I'll tell you what I used to tell my clients about snacking. I'd tell you that snacking is a made-up word. There's no such thing as snacks. There's incomplete meals and complete meals. And my goal is for every time that you consume food, we have a complete meal. So you have an urge to sit down and have a snack. We're not going to have a snack. Let's have a meal. Pair that with protein, get some good fiber in there, have a good amount of good, clean carbohydrates. Like, so throw out this idea of snacking and grazing throughout the day. Snacks are a made up word to market to people to buy shit and snack on it all day. You either are eating a complete meal or you're eating an incomplete meal. My goal for myself, my goal for my clients is to teach you how to make complete meals. It could be a small meal, it could be a very tiny meal, but I want you to eat a balanced complete meal. So that's how I used to tell my clients around snacking and teaching them to not snack.
Yeah. What you're doing is you're identifying behaviors and what works or doesn't work. Like, you know, because some people are actually the opposite. Some people are better off not eating for a period of time. Other, you know, because if they eat small meals, it actually makes them want to eat more and vice versa. So this is all an individual thing. And you got to kind of find what works for the person. So see how they work, how it works for them, I should say, how they feel, what encourages better behaviors and relationships with food. And then you can help, that'll help you kind of, you know, direct where you're going to go with this.
All right. Okay. Thanks. Thanks for your answers.
You got it, man. Thanks for calling in.
Hey, thank you guys. Bye-bye.
All right, dude.
Take care, man.
It did look like, It did look like he was in a steam room, huh? it's all foggy in there.
Yeah,
that's you know, the question about movement. I mean, he's a trainer, so he's overthinking things.
Yeah.
But it's just activity.
Yeah.
You know, really, like, you know, it's like, do I count every step I take as a calf raise? Because I'm
no, going but up a good discussion. But well, good activity, discussion though, because it did make me remember like the trainers that did work out. Yeah, with
group X instructors who used to do the class with the class. Yes, that was holding.
Yeah, that's a no brainer. Yeah. That to work out.
Like spin instructors.
But I did have trainers that loved to do that. Like I had some trainers that
they do like the medicine ball squat.
Everything.
With them.
They did everything with them. Yeah. They loved to get the little workout and sweat with them, and they found it, you know, inspiring.
I never could do. I never got that.
Hell no.
I do miss that though. Like unracking. Racking weights, yes. Like carrying it around just the standing. Gym like all day long, like just doing that.
Yes.
Because then, you know, the contrast of that now, of us sitting on our butt and then like being in traffic. And
totally.
It's just like,
and all day.
All day.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we got to, you know, make up for that.
And then the snacking thing, snack is made up. It's not a thing.
Yeah, no,
it's totally a marketing thing.
It's not a meal. It's a snack.
No, it's like you either eat a complete meal or you eat an incomplete meal. Yeah. And if you want a quote unquote snack, okay, well then we'll eat a smaller meal and let's make sure that we go. And here's why that's so important is like it's already difficult for people to hit their protein intake consistently. If you fill up the day with these little mini snacks of incomplete meals, meaning that you're not balanced with some protein in there with the right ratio, like 20, you're not going to hit. You're not going to
carb heavy.
That's right. Yeah. They're almost always carb. Nobody snacks on a chicken breast.
You know what this came from, by the way?
I'm saying? Like everybody snacks on crackers and shit that is
By
like,
the way, you know where this came from? This came from the myth that you need to eat throughout the day small meals. You know, before that, like snacking, and it was the food industry. The food industry really pushed this, like, what are you going to do for snacks? And what about in between meals? Like, how are we going to sell more products when you're not actually sitting down to eat? Like,
yeah,
it's just it's totally a made up thing.
Our next caller is Brad from Washington, D.C.
Brad, what's happening? How can we help you?
What you producing back there?
Oh, are you call center? What's going on?
Don't worry about it, you know?
It looks like some CIA shit. Hush.
Hey, it's the NSA. They finally got a hold of it.
You see a, you see a
whoa,
video.
Whoa, easy guy. Right? I'm not trying to lose my job here. Come on.
What's happening, man? How can we help you?
So first of all, thank you guys. You guys hear it all the time, but you're the best. Love your content. I've been listening since about episode 500. So I've been around a little while. Not quite since the beginning, but... damn near close to it. So love you guys.
Awesome.
Adam, I want to thank you especially for, you know, your advice helped me, you know, cull my horse inventory. Many fewer horses than I used to have. So thank you for that. By the way, that was me in the Facebook forum that posted that. I just wanted to shout that out.
Nice. Good stuff.
You have to let me know what happened.
I'm going to go ahead and get into my question here. So I've had incredible results with Aesthetic and Strong. And right now I'm kind of in a place where I want to get some, you know, work towards some new athletic goals. I'd like to cut about 10 to 15 pounds to become a little more agile and take a little bit of strain off of an ankle injury that I'm kind of rehabbing right now. 40 years old, 5'11", walk around at about 185, 12 to 15% body fat, and I'm kind of guessing on that. But I'd like to get to like 170 you know, maintain that body fat, right? So any lower than like kind of 10%, tends to affect my quality of life. And then, so my question is, how can I best, you know, lose weight without sacrificing too much strength, kind of with the understanding that, you know, there is going to be some strength loss there.
Brad, you know, you're 5'11", 185, your body weight's not bad for athleticism. So now if you were like 205, 210, 220, then I would give you advice that'd be a little more targeted towards losing size. But what I'll say to you is this. First off, is there a specific sport that you want to get better at, or is it just general athleticism?
So I play a lot of soccer. I'd like to try and, you know, get about two games in at least one game in a week, maybe two. And real quick, to preface that, I started this journey at like 155. So I've gone up to about as high to like 195, and it just feels, you know, when I'm running around,
sure.
it feels heavy.
Dude.
Yeah, for sure.
This is okay. So this is not going to be too hard.
This is all conditioning.
This is not going to be that hard for you. So what I would say is play more soccer, lift less weights, and don't worry too much about trying to cut your calories. Eat healthy And then what'll happen is your body will adapt to be better at what you're doing more of. So I would play more soccer. I would do strength training like once a week, a MAPS performance style workout. MAPS performance has the best athletic workouts. Play soccer 2 to 3 days a week, 1 day a week of strength training with that. And then your body weight should settle at a good athletic body weight without having to try to lose too much.
How long has it been since you played soccer?
I've been kind of taking it easy with my ankle for like the last 2 months.
Oh, okay. Okay. That's okay. Cause that was the one thing I would have changed advice wise. Cause like this is, I would love to go play basketball right now. And if I just started playing basketball right now, I would for sure tear something right out the gates if I didn't lean down or get smaller first.
You're also a big gorilla.
But you've already been playing soccer in the last 6 months. And so his advice is perfect. Like you literally, I mean, you could even reduce the strength training down and just be more focused on playing soccer. Like literally one day a week of lifting from MAPS Performance, and then the rest of it just playing soccer. And
your body will adapt.
Yeah. What does your mobility practices look like?
So I'm doing yoga at least once a week, and usually twice. But that's about it in terms of mobility.
I would try and get a little more specific with that, especially if, we're going to increase the amount of times that you're out there on the field and running around and getting a lot of impact on those joints, especially in the beginning. Instead of just the aimless workout or aimless warm-up, I should say, to be specific and get like good three like solid mobility exercises for you to just do prior to getting on the field and then also after, just to reinforce that and make sure that we're getting good stability control, and that's activated, so that way you're because this amount of impact it's gonna add up pretty quickly if that's gonna be your focus for a while. So
Justin, you have one off the top of my head. So I love is
combat
like,
stretch is one.
Yeah, go ahead. Combat stretch, a walking lizard with rotation. I love that for athletes like to warm up in because
dude, they call the world's greatest stretch.
Oh, that's what it's
if
called.
If you just did the mobility sessions for MAPS Performance.
But three specific good mobility things before you get into every soccer. Like you're not going to run a whole mobility flow before. Like literally that's the combat stretch.
And maybe inchworm.
Yeah, the world's greatest stretch. You're kind of hitting
well, it's kind of hitting with the world's greatest.
So those two for sure.
Yeah. Let's do that.
Something lateral.
Laterally. Yes. Yeah. Lateral lunge hop. I think that's in the MAPS Performance.
So those three movements every time before you get on the field like that, it'd be a great way to kind of prime the body before you get on the field.
Cossack squat. Same thing. Yeah.
Gotcha. Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. That's one thing I've noticed as I get older. Like when I was 30, it I could just jump on the field and run for 90 minutes and I'd be sore the next day. But it's nothing like it is now.
Yeah, I feel that.
Yeah,
I have to do that, dude.
And what do you think about so just lifting once a week? You think it'll be all right?
Yes, dude. Bro, you're gonna be fine. That's gonna be plenty.
Yeah, you'll trip out. Less is more at this point.
Yep.
Got you. And then protein. Yeah, I'm pretty dialed on the nutrition stuff. You know, protein about a gram per
keep it the same
gram per pound.
Yep. Yeah. Keep it the same. Don't cut your calories to try and lose weight.
That's actually probably the most important thing. You might even be able to get away with increasing calories a little bit because of all the extra cardio and movement you're going to be doing.
I mean, it'll bring his weight down. Is what'll happen.
Yeah. Yeah. So I mean,
keep it the same.
But keep that protein up. That would be probably the only thing that could sacrifice the muscle the fastest would be to all of a sudden just let go of hitting your protein intake area. But if you're good about that, one day of good strength training of MAPS Performance, mobility drills before you play soccer and start playing more soccer.
Yeah. A couple of weeks back, I cut calories pretty drastically by about 1,000. And I don't know, man, just felt like crap. It didn't really feel right.
Yeah. Predictable.
So, yeah.
Yep. Expect.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, cool. I appreciate it.
You got it, man.
All right, Brad.
Thanks, Brad.
All right.
Yep.
Go spy on people.
You got to fill me in on the horse thing. What was that all about?
I have no idea. I got to go to the forum and look. I'm trying to remember what he's talking about.
Maybe the horse is growing up.
Where someone
right?
says something and, once, and you're like, what? And then they say it again. You're like, huh? And they say it again. And you're just like, you're embarrassed to ask again. So you're like, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, oh, yeah, dude.
The only thing I could think of is when we were talking about you were teasing me about the horses, but then he says he let go of a bunch of
horses. What was I teasing you about?
No, I remember my family. Like, you were poor. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Or so, you guys own a bunch of horses.
Yeah, so I'm maybe Doug can look him up on the forum maybe and see.
Sold off some you know, horses this whole and, like and
financially sound. For
this
him.
Whole I need to lose a bunch of size to be more athletic. That's true when you're like big. When you're a big person.
Well, we were just talking about this. You and I were literally just before we got on the podcast, I made a comment to Sal that, hey, I'm gonna get really, really skinny and small. And he's like, what? What you mean shredded? And I'm like, no. I'm gonna start doing cardio crazy. He's like, dude, do you not listen to our podcast? Yeah. We tell you. I'm like, no, I actually want to lose muscle too. I think I want to just kind of shrink down completely.
What do you weigh right now?
I'm about 225, 230.
Yeah, see, that's you're a big dude, right? So, yeah. And but if you were like 205.
And my basketball weight is like 185, yeah. 190.
Well, I was going to say.
So that's like a huge
difference. Right, so let's say you were 205 right now.
Yeah.
All you would have to do, of course, with the prerequisites of having the mobility and all stuff, would just be play more basketball, lift less weights, and then your body will just adapt.
You'll form into it, yeah.
Totally.
Yeah,
totally.
That's the thing. And it does, I mean, a sport like soccer or like basketball, it's just like constant running, explosive movements. So to have like mass isn't quite as advantageous.
And it really matters when you're somebody who is 40 years old and when he was 30, he was used to being 150, he said?
155, yeah.
Yeah, 155, and you're at 30 years old. Now you're 10 years older and 30 pounds more on you. Like that makes a big difference. So
your basketball weight was 185?
Yeah, 185, 190.
Wow, what was your football weight?
I was 225.
So you're still beefy.
Yeah,
football.
Well, I mean, I got all the way up to
225. It's also though. I mean, it also speaks to why he's way more agile than we are today. Is that he's not that far off from his football
he's
weight.
He's got the thick ankles that support
constant square body.
Yeah,
yeah. SpongeBob.
Our next caller is Cassie from Montana.
Hi, Cassie. How can we help you?
Hello. Well, just like everybody does, I first want to say thank you and that I'm super excited to meet with you all. It's like meeting a celebrity, but honestly better because of the authenticity that you guys bring to your podcast. So I feel like I already know you all and that you're all super cool dudes that I would want to hang out with someday. It's just a big honor. And so I'm a little starstruck right now, but I'll stop fangirling and get into my question.
What a great compliment.
Yeah, thanks. So just a little bit of background. I've been lifting consistently for like 4 years. And after buying a bundle of your guys's, I realized how much I loved low rep strength training. And previous to that, I'd really only focused on like probably 6 to 8 reps and above. But I just have had a lot of fun with that. And I'm in the last part of your anabolic program right now. And I'm doing like I think it's 12 to 15. And I kind of just find myself getting bored at the end of that set, which maybe means I'm not going hard enough. But anyways, I feel like now training in higher rep sets, I get just bored and don't really want to do it anymore. So I know it's good to train both, but I would actually prefer the effects of hypertrophy training rather than the low rep training. So I feel like I'm in a weird place of like switching back and forth and not getting good effects from either, or good results from either, and just not really sure where to go next.
All right, Cassie. Well, first off, all those rep ranges build muscle. Okay. So I know that they label some hypertrophy and some strength, but they all build muscle. And then keep this in mind. First off, most people have a rep range that they prefer. So you're
normal.
You're common. Yeah. That's very common. Most people are like, I love all rep ranges. Some people like high reps and other people's like low reps. Doing the other rep ranges will make you better at the rep range that you enjoy doing the most. Okay. So avoiding the high rep training is actually going to start to hinder your low rep training. You may start to find your joint pain goes up a little bit. You may start to find that you hit plateaus much faster, or you're just stuck in a plateau. So you got to train in those other rep ranges if you want to continue to progress and avoid plateaus and avoid, you know, things like injury. Now, that being said, you don't have to spend equal amounts of time in each of those rep ranges. Now, I know we write the programs that way because that's a very balanced approach, but you could spend 3 weeks in a low rep range and do a week of a higher rep range and go back to low rep. Like you can play with it in that way to where when you start to feel the negative effects of the low rep, like for me, if I go low rep for too long, I start to notice it in my joints and then the connective tissue and at the insertion points of my muscles, I start to notice things stop feeling good and I start to plateau and I start to hurt a little bit, in which case I'll switch to the higher reps and I'll do it long enough to where I start to feel like I'm good again, and then I'll go back to low reps. Mm-hmm. So you could totally do that if you prefer the low rep train. There's nothing wrong with that.
Keep in mind that the thing that we tend to like doing the least tends to give us the best results. So all Sal's advice is correct, and I agree, and I think that's a totally good, viable strategy. But then also don't allow yourself to feel like in, you know, say a year or 2 years down your training, like, man, I just can't get past this plateau, or I'm really trying to, you know, lean out more, or I wish I was getting a little stronger. And you've been kind of training this way for a long, this is what happens. People, they fall in love with a rep range. They fall in love with a training modality, and they tend to stick in there 90% of the time. And then maybe they bounce out a little bit and go back in. And then they're frustrated because they're not seeing the change they want to see in their body, whether that be strength or aesthetically or whatever, performance, whatever. And the answer is like, well, how long has it been since you've done X, Y, or Z? And many times it's like, oh, well, I kind of do that, but then I get right back to this. And it's like, well, I know you don't like doing that, but if you actually stuck in that a little bit longer, you'd probably see more results in the direction that you want to go. So just keep that in mind as you are leaning harder into the, but to be honest, when I get a female client that I can get to actually love the low reps and lifting heavy, I tend to not.
That's a win.
Yeah, it is a big win. There's rarely ever I'm going to try and convince you to go the other way, because I think most women and people in general tend to do the high rep circuit training thing. So I love the fact that you like to strength train. And if there was a rep range that I would have you stick in the longest, it would be that.
Yeah, same. And that's the thing, is we all have our preferences. And it kind of to both their points, like the way that I tend to train for the most part is it would look like MAPS performance phase one, and then phase two I kind of interrupt it with. And so that, because of the fact that I'm training in multiple planes, and that's kind of the focus, but the volume's a lot higher, the reps are higher, and that's just a way to kind of break it up, but also account for my joints longevity, function, and, you know, my strength stability, and then I'll jump right back into doing like more lower rep type lifting with that as well. So it's like you can still kind of stay and hone in on what you like doing the best, but you do have to kind of break that up in order to maintain the long term.
Yeah. And my first, like I said, I've been lifting for like 4 years. The first two and a half years of that, I was only doing those higher reps. And so, like, unless I'd randomly throw in a one rep max in there, and then I'd just get frustrated and not do it for a long time, because I was like, well, I mean, I'm barely getting stronger, so why would I keep doing one rep maxes? But yeah, in the first phase of anabolic, I was like, okay, this is awesome. Like, it's a lot of fun and I can stay engaged in the whole set. And yeah, I'm hoping to move towards doing a little bit more of that. And it sounds like that's okay, and we'll still build muscle.
Yeah. Well, and you know, consider this too, as you continue on this journey or relationship with strength training, you'll start to develop different relationships with different types of exercise and rep ranges and you know, programming styles, because circumstances change, or you'll notice certain things about your body, or I appreciate higher rep training more now than I ever did, because I'm at a place now where continuing to push heavy weight just has more risk versus reward. And so now I actually find more value in some of that other training. So this is an ever-evolving relationship. So you're probably not going to be here forever, but nonetheless, you know, the advice we're giving you is a way to maintain good progress and health and do what you love doing the most frequently.
Yeah. So then for me next, I mean, right now I'm in the last phase of anabolic. I was thinking about maybe getting power lift. Is that something I should try? Or?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. We'll send that to you.
I would love to hear you go through power lift.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Cool.
Yep. You got it.
Well, yeah. Thank you guys. And if you have any other advice for that, I'm all ears. But otherwise, that was my big question and just kind of what direction I should go next. So if you guys agree with powerlift, then I'm super excited about that.
All right.
I love that idea. I think you're in an incredible place right now. This is a place I think we're trying to get most of our clients to get. So I think you're doing great. Just keep in mind all the advice that we gave.
Okay. Awesome. Well, thank you guys so much. And I look forward to listening to every episode in the future.
Oh, thank you.
All right, Cassie.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, you got to consider, like, what you enjoy doing is an important value and a factor that you want to consider. And there's nothing wrong with that. But it's just understand. It's
the most important.
Yeah, exactly. But just understand how to use all the other methods and tools in order so that you can do what you enjoy doing. Because if you, what you enjoy doing, if you do it too often, too frequently, and you don't pay attention to other things, then what sometimes happens is your ability to do what you love starts to decline because of injury, overuse, or imbalances.
You just need to understand the adaptation process with exercise in the body. And it's like what I used to tell a lot of the Orange Theory clients that I had that love to go to Orange Theory. And I say, man, you love to go. You have this routine. You go every single week. You hang out with your girlfriend at lunch afterwards. It keeps you consistent and keeps your cardiovascular endurance up. But you're plateaued. You're not seeing results. Well, there's a good reason why that is. Because that's what you've been doing for years.
Right.
And your body needs something else. If you need change. If you need change and want to see change in your body, then we need to change the adaptation. We need to change the way you're training in order for you to get to stimulate and see new change and growth in the body. So you have to weigh those out always. You have to be balanced. So it's totally okay to become this person who's always kind of training this way because you love doing it. It's what keeps you consistent. Just keep in mind if and when, and the when is for sure, that plateau comes. And if you're still seeking change and you want to see the body change in a different way, well, a good reason why it probably is because you're doing the same things that you've been doing for months or even potentially years.
Look, if you like Mind Pump, head over to Instagram, Mind Pump Media. You can get a workout every single week for under $5 a month. Mind Pump Media. You can also find all of us on Instagram. So Justin is at Mind Pump Justin. I'm at Mind Pump DeStefano, and Adam is at Mind Pump Adam.